Welcome, everyone. A reminder, we are streaming live on Ustream this evening. Right, Kim? Good. All right. We're gathered here this evening for a special city council meeting at 5:30 p.m. 209 Lemonwood Drive, Castle Hills. And I will call this meeting to order. It is now 5:31 and a half. And determine whether a quorum is present. A quorum is present. Item two on the agenda is consider and act upon ordinance number 201609-26, an ordinance adopting the fiscal year 2017 budget. I will be, as required, a roll call vote. And to open it up for discussion, do I have a motion, please? And the second is by Matt Daggett. Thank you, Matt. So we have a motion and we have a second. All right. We'll start off with discussion. Mike, did you want to say anything? You want to dive right into it?
Proceed, Mayor. Thank you.
Thank you very much. All right, I think we're going to start to the right today. Douglas, do you have any questions or comments regarding the budget, please? Take your time.
I need some clarification by Mr. Shands. How many people do we now carry in staff in the police department?
Excuse me, 22 full-time uniformed officer slots.
Does that include dispatch?
That, just a moment, that does not include dispatchers or anyone else.
How many people do we carry in the fire department?
I'm sorry, let me come back to that. We're gonna have to have each of the chiefs address this more clearly than I. In the 20,
Yeah,
in the 2017, yeah, this is, yeah. In the 2017 budget you're talking about?
Mm-hmm, okay. Yes, sir.
Or the current, they'd both be the same. There are 22 full-time officer slots, and how many dispatchers and people like that?
Fine, I'll get back to that question.
Okay. And on... And then there are 19 full-time firefighters.
In the police department, I have a memo that you sent me quite a few years ago. I just want to go down here quickly. In the police, there's one chief. Is that current today? One chief, one lieutenant, four sergeants, four corporals, 11 patrol officers, one chief dispatcher, four dispatchers, and one records clerk. Is anything different from what I've just read?
Can you read it again, Mr.?
Yeah, one chief, obviously, one lieutenant, four sergeants, four corporals, 11 patrol officers, one dispatch officer, four dispatchers, and one records clerk. Under this memo, all that came under the police department staff.
What year was that?
2003.
I believe we have five sergeants currently, a captain in lieu of the lieutenant.
We don't have a lieutenant now?
No.
Okay.
It's just a title change.
Okay. Same dispatchers and chief dispatcher and patrol officers, and same patrol officers.
Five sergeants.
How many corporals?
Three.
How many patrol officers?
Eleven.
One chief dispatcher. How many dispatchers other than the chief? and records clerk is no longer applicable. One. Five, six, nine, ten. Okay. In the fire department, chief, I have you down as one chief, one assistant chief. How long have we had that assistant chief job vacant?
3 years.
And three shift captains and 15 firefighters, is that correct?
And myself, a captain on each of the three shifts, lieutenant on each of the shifts, a second charge, and then four firefighters, six per shift, three shifts.
And in public works, we have, this is as of 2003, we had one director, two drivers. Are we still with two drivers, Rick?
Yes, sir.
Sanitation collectors, we have four.
There's two collectors right now and two vacant collectors, sir.
And streets and animals, you have down at three.
We have three streets and one admin.
Okay. In the administrative branch, we have one city manager, one city clerk, excuse me, one city secretary. Is that still correct? And what? One court clerk, two court clerks. We don't have an assistant city manager. Do we have any more people? Well, how many did you say? Nine. That's up from four. It's in 2003. I want to go to the fire chief first. Chief, wouldn't you say that your department is responsive and effective now as it has ever been? Do we need, since it is as effective as it's ever been, do we need to fill the position of assistant chief since it's been vacant for 3 years? So the position of fire chief, which hasn't been filled for 3 years, is just a temporary thing.
That's correct.
To acclimate somebody to come in.
Correct.
For the police department, I want to thank Mr. Paul and I want to thank Ms. Wenger for their lengthy tomes that have been sent out to the people to discuss the various things that have been going on in the police and fire and sanitation department. Less information is never good than more. So thank you both. One thing that's been brought up with the police department is that we've had a strong increase in drug-related crimes and picking up more drug paraphernalia. Is that correct? Was this, did this come about in part due to the expansion by 200 yards of what we can now patrol in the perimeter of the city? Is that the primary responsibility for this increase? Or have we had a huge increase of drug traffic within the old boundaries of the city?
The extended jurisdiction likely just complements the increase that we have been seeing since 2014.
So the answer is yes.
It complements it, yes.
Okay. In the additional police officer, which is, what is it, 40% funded by the state, something like that, 50% funded by the state?
I think it might be a little bit more than that, so a little over 43,000, 44,000, 44,000.
So has this been primarily due to that increase of 200 yards of the perimeter of the city, which is now bringing in the additional drug crime?
No, that's not part of that, no. Just because we have an extended jurisdiction through SB 631 isn't a result of us getting an extra position.
But has it had an impact that additional police officer, is he patrolling that slot, patrolling that area right now?
All of our officers are patrolling that area.
I understand that.
I mean, it's a little too gray to try to identify what you're looking for, if you could redefine your question.
Well, let me put it another way. If we had the same number of police officers on the force last year that we had, would we still be bringing in the amount of drug paraphernalia that we're bringing in now?
Without the extended jurisdiction?
Mm-hmm.
Probably not the exact amount of number. There's a slight increase, likely because of SB 631.
Okay. For the sanitation department, Rick, my hat's off to you. You're still doing the same stuff you were doing when you were in your 30s. I don't see how you've done it as you get older. As head of the department, I would hope you'd do more inside stuff than outside stuff, because it'll kill your back. But I wanted to ask you about the person, your assistant, who's being elevated from part-time to full-time. What is the primary reason that she's being upgraded from part-time to full-time?
Well, the reason that came into the first admin that we had, she started working on a part-time basis only because of the fact that it was only more administrative work as to doing payroll and some of phone calls that needed to be done on the public works. But then more came into play. She was coming in to also work on street work that we were getting involved with on different phases, and also a software cardiograph.
I've sat in only a couple of these street meetings recently. Do you understand the cardiograph numbers that they're coming in, or is she the sole person in the department who understands any of this stuff?
Both of us, sir. Otherwise, we would not be both paying as users for what's going on cardiograph.
So this is something that you couldn't do if you were inside more as opposed to outside. This is something only she can do?
No, sir. No, because we both got iPads. I'm able to do field work and process that information into the iPad, which will be put in onto the cloud, which she's able to take from the cloud and in process and update information into cardiograph.
How much of this work on cardiograph is now taking up her time? Is this half of her time, a third of her time? What would you guess?
Right now, almost about 75%, because we're still putting in data the process of getting all cardiograph did with going and screening all the streets, that all got done. Then that took almost a year just for that information to go through. Then after that, then we started putting in our data from our streets and all the update information that Clark and Easy Bell New Construction, plus the public works team doing our work on the streets, is all getting inputted into all that cardiograph to bring the percentage and the assets of what's all being done on our streets.
So, but for cardiograph, she probably wouldn't be needed.
I'm sorry, I misunderstood that question.
But for the amount of time, if she's putting in 3/4 of her time on the input of the cardiograph information, she probably wouldn't be needed as a full-time employee?
No, sir. I'm going to still say there's still a lot of street work that's still involved. The new phases that we're getting involved with all the street work being done. Remember, cardiograph is just a source of a tool just to keep all our information. Yes, we have to have that, but we are also having processes with each phases that we're being put through. Going on the second phase right now, still have four phases to go that we've already generated with all the information to get done each year. That's gonna get all that work done, both by both of us, not just myself or her.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
In the administrative branch, we've had an additional influx of, what was it, $200,000 this year that came from the signs. Approximately $200,000, a signing bonus and from the two signs. Was it approximately $200,000? Mm-hmm.
what we budgeted for this year.
How much of that went to infrastructure repair?
All of it.
And the percentage was 80-20. What type of surplus did we run this year in the total budget, or we expected to run in the total budget? And at 54,000?
Excuse me, just for a second. Douglas, you are the treasurer, is that correct?
I think it is, but of course this has been a fluid document since we've been going through. This is why I've waited till the last day to hear everything and to see all the various documents. I just want to know if the final numbers are still correct. Is it an estimated surplus of around $54,000?
This last budget that you have's got 31,147.
31. So without the 200,000, we would have a deficit of about 170,000. 200 minus 30. What did we do with that $170,000?
From digital billboards?
Mm-hmm.
It's still in Fund 10 and Fund 8.
No, I mean the 200 that's coming in versus the estimated surplus of 30 means that you have $170,000 difference. My question is,
that is not affecting the general budget. Digital billboards does not affect the general budget at all because the general budget doesn't receive any funds from digital billboards. It's all allocated to Fund 10 or Fund 8, drainage or street maintenance.
So it's not in the street maintenance line, it's away from that.
No, right. It's not.
One last question is, of this presentation, how many new full-time positions are estimated to be filled this time? And how many new part-time positions?
Three full-time.
Doesn't it have to, the one part, you have to have at least, do you count the additional police officer a full-time or part-time? Okay. That's all I have at this time, thank you.
Thank you, Douglas. Mr. Paul, did you have any comments or questions regarding the budget to the staff?
Chief, I was under the understanding that we have 20 officers plus one special unit officer, which is 21 people on the force as far as the police, right?
That's correct. We have we may look at it a little differently, but I carry commissions. And I have 21.
Counting you.
Yes, counting me and counting the task force officer.
How many years have we been at that level?
I would look back at this earlier today. It was, we looked in, went back to 06. I think Mr. Shantz, we were talking earlier about it. 03, okay, yeah, it was 03.
Been a while. Since then, obviously, many things have increased. I put out some numbers that we all had access to during the meetings. And since the beginning of 2014, which means that SB 631 wasn't effective until January of this year, our narcotic arrests are up 33%. Now you stop me and correct me anytime I'm wrong. Our total arrests are 31.48%. Our investigations, which are very extremely time consuming, is 12.41%. And our crime investigations are up about 28%. And of course, when citizens ask for patrol buys to check on them and make sure everything's okay, we're up about 13.5%. If we were a sleepy little city, didn't have 410, didn't have people ingress and egress in our city at a ridiculous rate, I can understand a little concern, but as far as I'm concerned, I look to you, your total budget is only up like 2.58%, if I remember correctly. I don't have the numbers with me. But, and that's including the additional officer. So, I don't know. Either we operate as a city, take care of the needs of the citizens, or we just say, San Antonio, come get us, we're another subdivision. And I choose not to do that the best way we can. And it, take, for example, sanitation. Rick's asking for make sure he has two people on a truck instead of one. Seems to me to be very reasonable to have two people at the back of a truck instead of one. We used to have two people, and we need two people. And, of course, there's a lot of issues there, safety issues, time issues, efficiency issues. I guess I get a little confused. If you're involved and see what goes on around the city, and you see the needs and see what's necessary, I don't understand why we are trying to micromanage the department managers in a request for something like they need an additional personnel, the first one in 13 years or 14 years in the police department. And we've already seen additional use of our officers in patrolling our city, the boundaries that we now have created. At this point, I don't have any more questions.
Thank you, Mr. Paul. Mr. Squire, did you have any comments or questions for staff?
Thank you, Mayor, just a couple. And Mr. Gregory, Mr. Paul, thank you for your questions. Douglas, you even brought a couple more questions I wanted to ask, so I sure appreciate that. I guess first of all, I started off last time, and without getting specifics yet, what I want to make sure of is, Mr. Shands, same question, different day. I mean, is this budget appropriate for this city, including the staffing and the budget amounts by department? Is this something that you would put your stamp on as a, because I'm looking at your experience here as we move forward. Okay, thank you, Mr. Shands. I wasn't quite sure on something, and Suzanne, you brought up that we're bringing three full-time positions on plus one part-time position on. What is the part-time position?
The part-time is an assistant for me.
Okay, okay. So financial assistant. And that she's been a temporary currently? Okay, and so she'll be moving from a temporary into a part-time position, is that correct?
Yes, she's already been with us for a little over a year now.
Okay.
And what we did was, if you'll notice from last year, we moved the part-time money
mm-hmm.
into full-time salary, so that pays for her.
Okay, okay. Thank you for clarifying that. I appreciate that. One thing was brought up about in sanitation about an admin assistant was moved from part-time to full-time. To my knowledge, when that admin assistant was brought in, that was always a full-time position. That's never been a part-time position. Now, how it was charged out in the departments, I'm not aware. I don't know how that money was moved out. But that person, that first person first came on board 2 or 3 years ago, that was a full-time position. Is that correct or not?
She was brought on part-time to see if it was going to work out between she and the department. It did. And a month after she was brought in as full-time.
Okay, so for approximately the last 2.5 years, we've had a full-time admin over at in Public Works, is that correct?
Yes.
Okay, so there's no change there?
No.
Thank you. There was, I'll skip that for now. Besides the last budget that we looked at a couple weeks back, I would like to ask either Mr. Shands or Suzanne, however is it more appropriate, what specific changes have been made to this budget versus what we looked at 2 weeks ago? Or is it, are we looking at pretty much the same budget?
The only changes that have occurred to the budget since the first budget back on August 19th were the two line items that you approved, the permit fees
And that was the reduction from 300 to 290,000 for the permit fees? Okay, and then the judges and prosecutors salary from 32.5 to 50, is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay, the only changes then. Okay, thank you. This time I have no more questions, Mayor. Oh, wait a minute. I have one request, though, I'm sorry.
Sure,
of course. One thing I asked for, and this probably would have helped Mr. Gregory out considerably in his questioning, but one thing I asked for several weeks back is a org chart of the city and city employees. I would like some support here, too. I think it'd be appropriate to have that org chart completed as a living document so we can be up to speed on our employees. Okay, thank you.
Mike, just so you know, it's not completely your fault because Kim, behind the scene, has been updating the phone numbers, which to make sure that what she gives you was correct. That's correct, Kim? Okay, good. Thanks, John. That's a good idea. Mr. Daggett, did you have any questions or comments regarding the bear?
Chief, since 2003, what has been approximately the call volume increase in our city up until now? Not including SB 631, but even before that came in, what was approximate call volume increase, just so people have an idea of that?
Call volume, we're on, last year, and don't quote me, but we were in the low 20,000 range, 21,000 for total calls for service. This year, we're anticipated to hit around 24,000. The year before that was, I believe, around 19,000 calls for service. So we've seen an increase in calls for service, for the last several years.
Okay, but
for certainty.
Back in 2003, when we approximately had the same number of officers, how much is it?
Yeah, it was quite a bit lower. It was quite a bit lower. I was in investigations at that time, and I can tell you that our I cases, we're probably around the 700 mark, maybe 800 mark, and I think we're, and in 2015 we hit 1176, and those are specific criminal cases that our investigators have to work. Now it's cyclical to some degree, but consistently, or since 2014, we've seen an increase to 15, and we're anticipating obviously an increase at the end of 16.
Sure, and that's not even including SB 631. So almost a 75% increase in cases.
We've only had 6 months of data to work off of with SB 631.
Right.
To be perfectly honest.
And we're adding one more officer for almost 75% increase in load.
Yes, sir.
Since that time. That's all I got.
Thank you, Matt. Mr. Trevino, did you have any questions or comments for staff, please?
Yes, sir, Mayor, thank you. Mr. Shands, I'm under the impression that bringing on Nora as a permanent employee will save us some money. Is that correct?
That's correct. It won't save us going to be a wash,
so we'll get more work for about the same amount of money. Okay, thank you. Chief, SB 631 gives us 200 yards outside of the city, is that correct?
Yes, sir.
So approximately 600 feet.
Yes.
But the officers almost always travel or work the areas that are the streets, which is approximately 60 feet, right?
Right.
They're not going into San Antonio to patrol. It's just if they happen to be on one of the perimeter roads, they can observe and make traffic stops.
Yes, sir, if it warrants the action by the officer. It's not a primary target, and that's not our goal with SB 631. And truth be told, SB 631 is clearly it's a court's jurisdiction law, not necessarily a police officer's jurisdiction law. it allows officers to file municipal citations in our court rather than having to file them in San Antonio.
And you brought up the point that SB 631 has been in effect since January 1st of 2016?
Correct.
But we've seen increases in 14 and 15.
Yes, sir. Yeah. The workshops, we provided that information, went back to 14 to 15, 15 to 16, and anticipating the last 6 months of 16.
So the overall 30% increase isn't drastically because of SB 631. SB 631 only has a minor role in that.
I put it the best, and I can't change my story on this. I think it just complements the increase that we're seeing.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Trevino. First of all, I want to thank everyone up here for the first round. I'm sure we'll go through many of these this evening before it's over. Chief, you know, since Douglas brought this up, and I guess we're using it as a benchmark now, 2003, in your opinion, because it relates directly to the budget and the hiring of an individual, what is the percentage of violent crime that you run across now? Violent, we're talking about assault, we're talking about high-speed chases, we're talking about things that aren't very nice, other than just regular stops. What, off the top of your head, the type of violent crime?
Well, that's kind of broad, but since you mentioned assaults, we've handled 19 this so far this year. Violent crimes, we don't have them broken down quite like that on the readily available, but overall, felonies, criminal activity is up. There's no question about it.
I hear a tone in the air, and I don't know, maybe it's just me, but I hear a tone in the air that SB, let's get it right, 631 is a something that's costing us money, something that's, I don't know, maybe I'm hearing the wrong tone. I do, at 62, I have a problem hearing. But I do want to ask you, because of that law and because we can go 600 feet out, wasn't that not only, and I'm not going to share my thoughts in the same sentence because I realize we can't talk about income, but wasn't that purpose to, kind of put a zone out there, or like a demilitarized zone, excuse the expression, or a buffer between, you know, where people know that, hey, we can now go 200 yards out and we're not going to, it's Castle Hills.
It was originally brought on by the citizen. I mean, I was getting letters and I've shared them with council from just folks randomly sending them in about speeders. Speeders on our perimeter streets. San Antonio is understaffed. They're not directing their units to handle streets, you know, Jackson, Keller, Blanco, Lock Hill, Selma. We're there anyway. And there was an opportunity for us to move forward with help from those on council and former council to get this done with the assistance from SAPD and all the other area chiefs, or a lot of the area chiefs around. So we accomplished that. And now we're addressing it accordingly, but we're certainly not abusing it.
Okay. As it relates to just things in general, your professional opinion as the chief of police of the city of Castle Hills, has SB 631 helped keep crime out of our city?
I believe it has.
And it's a safer place than it was, possibly even in this benchmark we're using in 2003. All right, we'll move on. Okay. Rick, when we brought on Cartograph, and of course, I mean, up until a couple of months ago, or maybe longer than that, it was, you know, you'd say Cartograph and everybody would give you a deer in the headlight. You know, and we didn't know. And I think I asked a year and a half ago, what is cartograph, and everybody, you know, kind of kicked the dirt and moved around and things like that. John came along with and actually helped in that program with you and Leanne. The cartograph system and the time and the effort and the employee that runs that is how important to your to your projecting future phases of our street program, which is the first one we've ever had in the history of this city.
Well, I'm gonna also give you some information you left out. It's not just how important it is for the phases. It's also important for maintaining our streets for any type of utility cuts that are being done here throughout any type of CPS, saws, or any excavation that are getting done to make sure that our streets are brought back, because they carry and hold a percentage grade on each street. So we're able to go ahead and have the utility company come back and actually do more for that area of the streets to get done. So it's also a plus on that side. And for the phases that we're getting involved to getting the streets done, cartograph keeps all the information of all the work that's being done and all the repair work.
Okay. Just so council is clear, Rick, what new responsibilities did we put on you as far as responsibility of your job and what you do 60 days ago?
Okay, I'm trying.
It took place in a street meeting there, as far as the vendors are concerned. Where does the buck stop, Rick?
Well, I mean, I still work on streets. I manage everything and anything on streets.
Yeah, well, it stops with you, if you remember, because what we did is we turned all the vendors over to you.
Oh, yes.
And we turned all the paperwork as far as what we were doing in these different phases of the street, which directly relates to your employee, I think, Leanne.
Jeanette.
Because she does more. I'm sorry?
Jeanette.
So with that said, she does more than just works on cartograph and works on that, but she also helps you in moving forward with our street program and things like that. Is that correct?
Pretty much an itemized list. She does payroll. It helps out. She makes activity, helps out with the activity report to go ahead and put into your package. She also involves with the phases that are involved with street work and all information of updates on the streets in cartograph. So
okay.
There's a pretty good list of all the stuff that she does for the public works as an admin.
Okay. I was just wondering, because as a department head, I don't think anybody does their own payroll per se, but also has a person that goes out.
Mayor Manica, comment here?
Of course.
Just to help as an education and kind of an trying to tag off of what Rick was bringing forward. You know, I was a advocate of a data-driven street maintenance program, and there basically was two large software packages out there that you could utilize to run your maintenance programs, cartograph being one of them. And they, after looking through, and council made the approval to approve that particular maintenance program, and it's a database-driven program, and I think what Rick's trying to bring forward is the fact that it took a lot of work initially to get the data in there to where we could, you know, could look at the streets, look at the condition, determine the index of the streets so we knew where we stood as far as the condition of all streets. And we're definitely not there where we need to be as of on the condition of the streets, but we're getting a lot of a move to that level. And one of the big things is we actually this group here passed the ordinance to where if we have a repair that's done, the condition has to be taken into effect. They have to bring the street back to condition it was previously. Not only that, it has to be curb to curb, and the condition of the street drives that. I think the percentage of the street is help me out, Rick, 50%. Is that where the number is? They have to do curb to curb. If it's less than that, they can just do the cut. Is that correct?
Yes. And that's where you come in saying that it's a plus, because a lot of times before, they would only do the excavated area, give a small patch. Well, then the street would all end up failing. So now the percentage with the street having the number that you just stated would also give us more of the area to go ahead and take care of the underground of the base and seal the whole area so that water wouldn't get into it.
And the value in our case is as they do these curb-to-curb repairs, when they do make a cut in the street, it saves us long-term because, number one, it shifts the cost to the contractor to keep that section repaired properly as when they do their work, and you have a new pavement surface to work from. There's a lot of cost savings in there, I think going forward, and we don't get these tiny little cuts everywhere in our streets that cause the premature failure of the streets.
Most definitely.
So, and that's an ongoing issue. That's why that particular database management system is so critical, because number one, we have a way to, if we get an argument between the contractor, we have the tool to show this is the condition of the street, this is why you have to do what you have to do by ordinance, and they cannot buck that. Very, very important tool to have in our pocket, in my opinion. And also, too, as far as the maintenance program goes, it gives us a target to shoot at of where we want to go ahead and maintain our streets going forward. And it's a great tool to help manage the program. And it's irrespective of who's managing it, you can continue to use that tool long-term. Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you. Suzanne, I just want to make sure I was clear, this new part-time person that we're bringing on. So do part-time people get benefits?
I have her slated for 30 hours, so yes, she will.
Okay, all right. And we said it was kind of a break-even based on the fees and everything that we were paying the employment agency. Is that correct?
Including benefits, yes.
Okay. I got to go back to the benchmark, 2003. Mr. Shands, are we, just off the top of your head, what's the increase of the budget of the city from 2003 to today? Just, we had what, $3 million back then, and?
You know, I recall in that period, probably high threes, low fours.
Okay, and we're at what today?
Seven,
so we're double since 2003. Working on about the same staff. Okay. It's good information. Thanks, Douglas, for bringing that up. Don't worry. We'll have several go rounds like this, I'm sure. Oh, Mr. Shands, while I'm asking about funds, this is not question, obviously, is not directed towards the chief of police. Court, what's the percentage of dollars that we're up from last year to this year? Rough?
If you've got over there, Suzanne, look it up. But you're talking about the income from court?
Right, income.
I think if I look at the first page here, if we look at, I wish this was alphabetized, but court income proposed in 2017 is $650. And if you look at the collections, that's another 73. So that would give you somewhere around, just right there, around $700,000+ that we projected for 2017. And if you look at the other incomes that we have, what's very interesting is that obviously property taxes are $3.2 million, sales tax is about $1 million, and so the court income is the third highest revenue generator in our budget. I'm not bragging about that. Don't take me wrong.
Percentage
it does
from
tell
this
you
year, last
that
year.
There's a lot of
court
a
income.
Lot of activity in the court.
Okay. 20%? 30%?
Of our total budget?
Mm-hmm.
No, of our total budget.
No. Of the percentage of increase from last year. Last year's figures versus this year's figures. Rough
Okay, the last complete year we had was the end of 2015. We were at 507. Mid-year here, we were at 310. So it's not going to be, if that continues, we would be at like 620, and we're saying 650.
Double.
I'm sorry?
Double. We're looking at court income, Mike. Court income.
Right.
Versus last year and what it's projected to be now, it's going to be 50% up.
No, sir. No, sir. What I'm saying is that the 310 is through the first 6 months. So it's looking to be approximately the same, maybe a little higher. We would be, if we projected forward from just the data we have right now, January through June, we're at 310. If we continue that through the end of the year, it would be at 620. So when we've projected 650, assuming.
Right, and you're telling me that last year was 500.
Last year, 2015, was 507. So it's gone up 20% projected ahead. Plus another two, so 24% over.
That's what it sounds
15
like to me.
Over 16.
25.
Yes, sir.
Right. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Thanks.
Mm-hmm. Misunderstood your question. I'm sorry.
No, I understand. Thank you so much. You're going to try to do that with one man, Chief? Okay. Douglas, you said you had some add-ons. Go ahead.
Yeah. Suzanne, what is the increase this year over last year on street maintenance and repair?
The increase of what?
The amount of funds allocated for street repair and street maintenance. But I want her to answer it.
Well, we allocated $250,000 for this year. And we're looking at $250,000 for next year in sales tax. We're looking at $19,000 in billboard rental. That's what will be going directly to street maintenance fund in 08.
So it'll be an increase of about $19,000?
Yes.
Okay. Throw some other facts around and figures. In 1980, we were over 5,100 people in the city. We're now 4,000 people in the city. In 1980, we had 51 full-time employees. We've had a 20% reduction of population. In 1980, we have 51. We're now projected to have 65. That's a 30% increase in employees from 1980. It's very interesting to me, this is typical of government, that you have a decrease in population of a significant amount and an increase of employees of a much more significant amount. Now, I do understand the traffic on 410 is a lot greater now than it was in 1980, and we have the STEP program to go after that, and that's why we have an increase in that. But I don't quite understand, if we have a drop of population of 20%, where is all this drug activity coming from? Is it from people we are stopping on 410, or is it people that we are in the perimeter streets? We're catching somebody and they have it in their car. And of course the city doesn't benefit from that. The police department does because you can take the car over and that becomes part of your seized assets fund, of which we have no control over. But where is this drug activity coming from when the population has dropped 20%?
Well, the residential population likely has dropped, and I think those numbers are close to accurate, what you mentioned. When I started here in 1997, there was a two-lane road, which was Northwest Military Highway, and there was a two-lane road, which was West Avenue. And it became very congested. And it now is a five-lane road with a turn lane in the middle on Military and a four-lane road on West Avenue. Those aren't all our residents, but those are people that we have to protect and serve, just as if they were residents when they're in our city. So you asked specifically about the increase in the drug activity. San Antonio's population is growing at about 4.2%, which means our transit activity is increasing by 4.2%, and we're responsible for those people. So the drug activity comes from all areas, Mr. Gregory, Military, Lock El Selma, Blanco, West Avenue. So to pinpoint it the way that you may be interested in us pinpointing it, we cannot. But what we can say and support is there is an increase, and I don't think it's all our residents committing all those crimes, but we have to deal with all citizens in our town at any given day or night.
Well, I one map that I saw from your predecessor, he showed it to me about a year before he was about to leave. He showed me a map of the drug crimes and violent crimes that were committed in Castle Hills, and then the surrounding areas of Castle Hills. And we look like an island surrounded by just a jillion number of crimes that were being committed, especially the gangs over in the high school. I was told there were three major gangs over there. But the drug seizure activity wasn't anything that it then as it is now, even though crime was pretty rampant around Castle Hills, but not in Castle Hills. So it goes to the question, is this bill that I supported and went up to Austin with you, I barely made it there, I was with the mayor and he has sort of a lead foot on the gas pedal, so we made it in jig time. Is this increase of drug activity it's a pronounced increase. Is it now being caught because we're now patrolling 200 yards outside of the old original perimeters of the city, namely Lock Hill, Selma, Jackson, Keller, and the like, and we're catching people on Lock Hill, Selma, or when they turn off into the other places? Is this is where all the drug activity is coming from, the increase? When we didn't have this type of increase 10 years ago, we're having this significant spike now. I'm just trying to get a grasp of why is it spiking? Because it's clearly spiking in the last 2 or 3 years, and it wasn't that way 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 years ago. It was rather steady.
Again, to get into it about is SB 631 a direct result of all this big increase, I simply go back to it complements what we're trying to accomplish with this mission. 14 to 15, there was a clear increase. We did not have SB 631. From 15 to 16, there is still an increase. SB 631 has contributed to a couple of those numbers. But I can't, until we have some hard data for a period of time greater than 6 months, you know, we're working off of putting our best foot forward on moving forward with trying to keep the violent crimes, the drugs, the citizens of Castle Hills who live here and who are traveling through here safer. And I know that the maps that you're talking about, it looks like we're on an island and we want to remain like we look like an island. And I think SB 631 is going to help with that.
Well, I hope 2 or 3 years from now we'll have enough statistics, because this police officer is being funded in part by the state.
By the feds.
It's renewed every year.
By the feds.
By the feds. And I hope after 2 or 3 years, if this budget passes and he or she is brought on, we'll be able to know in 2 or 3 years where this criminal activity has been coming from, if it's primarily been generated of the people we're stopping on Lock Hill, Selma, or 410. I think it's important to know, because that'll call into question whether or not we should be in this Austin bill or not.
Well, I can tell you that I...
Because we know that there's a hotbed of drug activity across the street from Lock Hill, Selma, near where the Walgreen drugstore is up in that area. We know that. You don't even drive through that area with your windows down in the middle of the day. We know that, but that's been like that for a long time, as long as I can remember. But I hope you keep the statistics over the next 2 or 3 years that'll be able to come back to council and say, drug activity has been centered so-and-so. It was primarily people we caught on Lock Hill, Selma, or 410, and due to the Senate bill, we're catching these people that we would not have caught in the past.
Well, I can tell you that most of our arrests come from folks that do not reside in Castle Hills. And that's not because of SB 631?
Well, I'll close it up for the rest of the council. The question arose is whether we are micromanaging. The council members have a fiduciary responsibility to the taxpayers and the citizens to have a working understanding of what's going on within the city. To blindly just agree to whatever the department heads say about something, I think it's a violation of that fiduciary responsibility. I don't think any of us do that. We all ask questions to one degree or another. And I hope that continues. And I appreciate your all's input. It's been very thorough this year. Thank you so much.
Chief, I wanted to say one comment and to kind of lighten it up here. Please don't answer the question regarding, the answer to drug activity, because we're streaming live, and I'm sure the DEA, we might lose a chief if he's got the answer to why. If he's got the answer to why drugs are coming through this city and it's up, what's the percentage? Never mind. It's big. Then we're glad to have you, Chief. We're glad that you create that buffer on a daily basis in order to keep us safe here. Mr. Paul, did you have any
I'm sitting here smiling at Mr. Gregory, expecting the chief to psychoanalyze all the people he stops that come through our city that they have to stop with drugs. We are a pass-through city, like it or not. They come through here. Chief, how many times these people at the bank that you off call for robbing, were they citizens of our city? No, of course not. Now, I shouldn't say of course not. They haven't been. As a rule, they won't be. They figure they can come here, they can hit, they get moving. They don't have a problem in their mind. So either we have a police department to protect our citizens, we have a police department to do the work, we have a police department that I'm not going to micromanage. Yeah, I ask questions. I think you know I ask questions all the time. But I had one person for the last 12 or 13 years, and we've had an increase in his activity. The Larkspur area, I believe you were talking about, Mr. Gregory, Jackson Keller, across from Castle Hills since 2008. All the apartments that have gone in there. And whether we have 4,000 citizens or 5,000 citizens, we are a city and we don't put borders up. So if we're not gonna have borders up, which I don't think we can or would, then we're gonna have to suffer any consequences that comes. We are a drive-through city in most cases. We're not a destination city. And this drive-through, as the chief said, the traffic is much worse than it is since 1997. So I'm a little confused. But anyway, I would like to ask one more thing. In a couple of the budget meetings, Mr. Shands, I asked about this lawn maintenance contract that we pay $20,000 a year for. Now, my understanding at the time when we asked questions in the budget meeting, that this is something that Rick feels he doesn't need and doesn't want. And the reason is because they have no accountability and they have no supervision when they are in our city. And he feels like it's a safety issue. And if our department manager wants to save $20,000, not have the lawn maintenance extra people come in here and do some work that he can do with his new personnel and everything, I don't know why we don't just kick the $20,000 out. Your thoughts on it?
I think that's a good thing for council to decide.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Well, am I right on my assumptions?
I would assume that if we have the staff to do it, that we should do it from within, and if we don't like the way it's done, we should change that.
Well, and that being said, again, I'm going under the premise that we had in a couple of the meetings that wasn't very well attended, that Rick said that he believes it's a burden to us, that he didn't want it and doesn't want it. And if I have no problem saving $20,000 and giving it a try for a year or two, so that's up to y'all decide, but that would be my vote to take that out of our budget. Thank you.
I'm gonna save my question for a second, but Douglas, go ahead.
Rick, have you, working on the assumption that you, I want you to be careful about this, please. we don't need this and you don't want this people to cut the grass. Is that correct? Have you always felt that way? Have you ever sent email messages to the people who are doing it saying how happy you were they were here, you were glad they were here doing what they were doing, and that changed about 4, 5, 6 weeks ago, but there are emails out there from you to the people of the lawn service saying how glad and happy you were that they were here doing the work they're doing. Do you recall sending any such emails?
I never sent not one email. Okay. I sent a letter I have on my phone, plenty of texts of all the activity and the processes that we at the Public Works team had always been doing, and that they are not doing the same processes as my boys are all telling me and myself, looking at what they're doing and their activity and how many times they're coming out, who's monitoring it. I am. Also, too, looking at the way they're doing any type of traffic control, they're not doing it. They're riding back and forth. They have their chutes open that actually can come to the liability of a rock hitting a windshield from a motorist passing by. They're also telling me that they can't do this or do that when the Public Works team was always doing it. And I don't see them why they should be here. I don't want to have to be monitoring and finding out that we have the city looking in the bad view, and that's the reason why we hired him in the first place. Well, then we're spending $20,000 for nothing.
Mr. Sands, is it true that they will be ticketed if they do any of the work that TxDOT has been doing?
I clarified that today, as a matter of fact, and the ticketing issue comes from just what Mr. Harada mentioned. If they are going counter to traffic, coming riding along the curb with their chutes discharging into the right-of-way, and if they break a windshield, they hit someone on a bicycle, they do anything that disrupts the normal flow of traffic or injures people or damages property, we will be the ones responsible. And so...
But we're not ticketed for doing the work.
They said, whenever I pushed hard on the tickets, one person said, we have the authority to do that. Are we going to come over there and ticket our partners when they are doing what we expect them to do, and all they need is just a reminder that they're doing it wrong? No, that's not going to result in a ticket. We will get a nice warning, a little visit at most. They look for us to correct that internally, which is what Mr. Harada has been addressing with the lawn maintenance people, and just reminding them that discharge internally, go in the opposite direction. If you're going to have heavy duty work out there, you need something that has chains or something that deflects. If you're going to be in the road, you must have, you know, people stationed at both ends. You must have traffic control. You must have warning devices, cones, whatever, barricades, things like that. And apparently, from what I understand, Mr. Rada, that just hasn't been happening.
Thank you.
Hang on just, Mr. Paul, did you have a comment?
Well, I was thinking that Mr. Gregory's, when I appreciate his fiscal responsibilities, I would think he'd want to save $20,000 as one of our managers, in fact, has a program that he feels he doesn't need. Now, obviously, we can manage it as we go along and see if it's needed. I would like to ask one more question of Rick. Rick, based on the conversation that I'm hearing one thing or another, I'm assuming that any time of the day, if I come over there and walk in your office, you're going to be sitting up with your feet on the desk and smoking a cigar. Is that right? Because everybody else is doing your work for you. I didn't think so.
I wish I could.
I didn't think so. Thank you.
Thank you. You know, this is, Douglas, thanks for bringing this up, because this has really opened up a can of worms on this $20,000 we're spending. Suzanne, do we have a certificate of insurance on these people? And I'm assuming we have a contract with them. Do we have a contract with the lawn service? Do we have a certificate of insurance?
To the best of my knowledge, we do. And I don't know if we have a contract. We'd have to review it.
I would like to, if you don't mind, Mr. Shands, let's make sure we have a certificate of insurance on these people. Because if they're cutting the grass out there with open, what'd you call it? Open chute, throwing rocks, everything into the street, hit a car, whatever it is, we need to have one if we don't. Rick, another question I had, now that apparently there's, in this particular budget, there's two people that you're going to bring on in vacant positions? Okay. Do we have the equipment to, do we have the equipment to maintain the highway?
Okay, sir.
Based on what this service is doing?
Okay, I'm sorry, but as Mr. Gregory was saying, something about being cited. Okay. The citation is brought in through with TxDOT. That would be only because of the fact that we're actually doing any type of work on the main lanes, which we're not allowed to because we don't have the equipment with chains on top. Neither does Fairway have the equipment to get up on the main lanes or do anything against the main lanes. We're only allowed to do the frontage roads going eastbound, westbound, and northwest military, anything that abuts the residential area, nothing else.
When these gentlemen finish their work, and I assume what, how long does it take, a couple of days to cut all that over there? Or is it a day, 2 days?
It's been looking like they're lagging out 2 days almost when the public works team is doing it.
When they do that, Rick, does someone report back to you, since they are a vendor and a contracted person with, I'm assuming, an insurance certificate, which we're going to check out tomorrow, and if they don't, anyway, does anybody check in with you to say, hey, did we do a good job? How does it look? What is going on? What?
Nothing at
so
all.
So are you supervising that now?
Most definitely, I feel I am.
Okay. But probably need to let them know that they need to come by your office and say, hey, we're through. The appearance of the city, of course, is number one. And, I heard a couple of meetings back that, you know, that we want to make sure it stays that way. Okay. Thanks. That's all I had to say about
Mayor,
that.
I have a question too, if I may.
Sure. Go ahead, John.
In regards to, you mentioned Mississippi Insurance, I haven't seen the contract, obviously, but also we got to make sure that we're indemnified too. Because if these guys are, you know, potentially doing something that's illegal or they claim, I want to make sure that the city's protected in that regard. So, in regards to that.
Thank you.
I got a question on sanitation.
Of course. Go ahead.
Go ahead. And one more item on this lawn care that we keep on bringing up, if I may. We're spending $20,000 a year. If they're not doing the job that they're supposed to be doing, why don't we look for somebody else? Or if we can do the job, then let's go ahead and do the job. I mean, the money's going to be expended by either our internal staff, which is probably more of a fixed cost, or them being more of a variable cost. But if we're not happy with what they're doing, we go find somebody else, at the very least, in my opinion. On sanitation, just to step back, and I should have brought this up earlier, so I apologize, but, you know, again, you're looking for two additional people for it to run these trucks, and so that would put a driver and two haulers on each truck. Is that correct? Mr. Shands, that's a typical
right.
amount? Is that a typical number of people that ride that run on a truck?
It's very typical. If you still have trucks, we're not typical in the way garbage is picked up nowadays, as we all know.
Because of what we do?
Because of what we do and because of some restrictions we have with our alleys that are not paved,
right.
with overhead trees that have to be cleared at a much greater height, you know,
right.
to allow the thing to be dumped. But for the ones, yes, sir, for the ones who still have manual garbage pickup and the service that we offer, you need two people, if for nothing else, one on each side of the road, so you just go down at once.
So I guess what is kind of driving my question to, and thank you for answering it, is, you know, we offer, in my opinion, a pretty much premier trash service or sanitation service for the city. I don't know of any other cities that offer what we offer to the level that we offer it. There may be out there, and if there are, please tell me. But I know we do quite a bit. May not be perfect, of course. Then again, in this world, nothing is. But I think we do above and beyond for the most part. And if we're going to run these trucks, we need to support these trucks. You got to have them properly manned, properly staffed, maintained. And I, for one, strongly believe that if you're going to have a service, you got to run the service properly. If you're going to have infrastructure, you darn well better take care of your infrastructure. And I think we're suffering because we didn't do that for so many years. And we kicked that ball down the road, and we're not doing that now at this point. And so I fully support making sure that this sanitation service is run properly. But on the flip side, if the citizens of this city feel that this is too much of a burden, we need to look at options. We need to look at outsourcing our sanitation service and look and to go to some of the majors, Waste Management, Republic, whatever's out there, and see if that would be appropriate. If there's a huge cost savings, we need to consider that. Just like outsourcing the care of the grass care that we're doing along the easements. You know, we need to, if that's the best option going forward for the city, we need to continue to look at that. Just like our police, if our police aren't doing the job, we bring Bexar County Sheriff's in and let them do the job. I'm not saying I agree with that. I'm just saying you got to look at it from a very pragmatic standpoint. Same with fire. If fire's not doing their job, you bring in San Antonio and let them take care of it. And those are things you just got to constantly consider as you're running your city. Now, I'm not a proponent. I like what we have. I like my response times, trust me. And I like having my things taken care of. I mean, I feel way more comfortable in the situation we're in. But you always got to compare yourself just to make sure. So, again, Chiefs and Ricks, I'm not an advocate of that. But I want to make sure we have to continue to look at that. Are we doing better with our resources? And again, I think we are. I really do. And so I like what I see. But we always have to consider those options. And if the citizens want that, then we're here to serve. And that's something that we have to look at and bring forward. So that's all I wanted to say on that. And I do appreciate your consideration. Thank you.
Thank you, John. Matt, did you have any follow-up questions or anything that you have brought up?
Okay. It's been brought up a number of times that our population is way less than it was 30 years ago. But just some thoughts. Do we have less homes? No. Except for Wedgwood. We have less streets? No. We have a lot more pass-through. So, yeah, you can't just look at one picture of the whole equation. We may have less residents, but we have the same number of actual residences that we've always had, if not more now, with all the subdivisions. People are keep trying to nail SB 631 as to the increase of why we need an officer. I think we've pretty much established that has been not the case. Case volume is way up, even way before that came in. So I don't know why we continue to beat that. Rick, the condition of our alleys was brought up. What issues do you see that need to be addressed in our alleys, and are we budgeting for it?
Well, sir, yes. There's conditions of the way the alleys are, especially on the south side, on the residential area, because their garages come through the back. They have to come in. We maintain those areas. Right now, sir, is only the phases that we have that are going to be done for the streets. But we will have to keep in mind that a lot of personal vehicles are low profile and scrape the bottom, so we have to maintain the alleys for that area a lot more than the north side.
Thank you, Matt. Mr. Trevino.
Yes, sir, Mayor, thank you. Rick, I have a quick question. When you collect the trash right now, there's only one gentleman on the back, correct? Does that mean that they have to go up the street and back, or does he run across?
He runs across, and that's another issue, safety side there. As Mr. Chan's mentioned, we try to keep the two collectors in the back so they're able to keep going straight ahead and the sanitation truck going forward. And also, please, Council, can we just keep in mind sanitation is not just sanitation. We also do recycle and brush. So there's a lot involved with that department. Thank you.
Thanks, Rick. I don't know, Mr. Douglas, I'm not sure if you've ever been on a police ride-along.
Yep.
Have you been around one recently?
No.
When I went to the night shift, and just seeing what the officers go through, I fully support the additional officer. Having to make an arrest and take somebody downtown leaves one officer in the middle of the night in Castle Hills unassisted. If we can have an extra officer to support that one, if anything ever happens, we know that we have the additional support necessary. I did look up some statistics, and we are up, San Antonio is up 40% population from 1980 to 2010. And I would attribute that to a lot of the traffic through Northwest Military and 410.
Thank you, Mr. Trevino. Gentlemen, we're at a point. Is there any other questions or comments you would like to make? Mr. Paul? Douglas? John? Okay, and wrapping this up and getting ready for the vote.
Mr. Mayor, excuse me. Do we need to amend the motion then? Because I would like to amend it to take the $20,000 out of the budget. And if our department manager doesn't think he needs it, I don't feel we should thrust it on him.
Okay, we have a motion on the table, and we have a second to move the budget forward. Mr. Paul, is that in the form of a amendment?
Do we want to review whether we have a contract with them first?
Well, obviously we'll do it as necessary. I've reviewed the contract, and I don't see it appears to me, we'll let our city attorney look at it, but it appears to me it's just a month to month.
Oh, okay, fine. I didn't see it.
But I agree with you. If for some reason we're stuck for 6 years, we have to stay for 6 years. I know.
Mr. Paul, you could make that motion based on the contract. Is that correct, Mike? He can make the motion based on the contract expiration or the earliest date possible to amend that.
So moved.
I would word it accordingly, you know, in other words.
That sounds good. I so move.
So let me understand, what you're doing is you're making a motion to terminate the lawn service that's charging right now $20,000 on the earliest possible time based on the contract.
Correct.
That we have in place. The contract expiration date that we can get out of. Okay. Okay, we got a motion on the table. Do I have a second?
A second. Actually, you got 3 seconds here. I'll have a second for discussion. I have some questions.
Okay, we have a second from Mr. Squire for discussion. Go ahead.
Yeah, and just thank you. I think we need to go over this, and thank you for bringing that up, Mr. Paul. But Rick, again, this came back and forth at that, and I'm still not clear 100%, but we have the equipment and the manpower to take over the work that's currently being done by this service. And we can do as good as or better job with the personnel we have in place today. Is that correct?
We don't just have the equipment, we have better equipment. Our shredder is a lot bigger than theirs. They only have ride mowers, which we can do a lot more, twice as fast. And we have the manpower as well. Yes, we do. We can cover it all, as we have been for the last 11 years that I've been Public Works Director.
Okay. Thank you, Rick.
I have a question.
Sure. Go ahead, Douglas.
They're doing it twice a month. How often do you cut these various things that they're doing? How often do you expect to be doing it?
Well, I'm going to say that that's a good question, because I wanted to let you know also, too, I would advise Fairway to go and make sure that these areas were cut on their holidays, because I knew exactly what you wanted to get done. So just coming back, I also had to watch that activity. But as myself, I make sure, not just twice, but three times sometimes in that month, because we start at a start point and go around the whole city looking and taking care of all the right-of-way easements that have to be cut. And then we even go maybe before the holidays to go ahead and make sure, because we know we have a long weekend to go through. Now remember, this is only on the right-of-ways, as I mentioned, on the frontage road going east and westbound in Northwest Military, only the easement right-of-way easements that abut the residential area and that triangle in the middle, no main lanes and nothing that goes on the side of the main lanes. So if you're looking at it and wondering why it's not cut, it's because it's that time frame when TxDOT comes out and measures and finds out with that scout when they'll be having their mowers in the area.
Question? Sorry, Mr. Shands, and pretty much the same question to Rick, though, but if we do take this service back internally, this is something that we can perform to the level that's being formed today or better? based on your knowledge of the equipment we have and the personnel we have in place?
Based on the comments I just heard and what I've seen, the answer, if they've been maintaining it for 11 years, something obviously went wrong that we changed it. My answer would be to that, from what I've heard, is that there was dissatisfaction with the way they were maintaining it. We should have corrected that internally and never addressed this issue in the first place.
Thank you, Mr. Chance.
Thank you, Mike. Okay, so we have an amendment to the motion on the table. Did y'all get it? Okay, good. We have a second. We'll hang on just for a minute. Okay, we'll go ahead and call the vote on the amendment. All in favor? All opposed? Okay, so it's 4-1. Thank you, Council. I'll get with you on the word. Okay, so we're back to the original motion, and before I call it, I just want to say, I just want to be perfectly clear, Mike, in your experience, not only with your years as a city manager, but your time with Castle Hills, your work that you've done putting together this sensible budget, and would you put your stamp, Mike Shan's approval on this budget?
I think this is a good budget, and the thing that bothers me about this budget is any budget. When you look at the carryover, it's not enough. We've got 31,000. We had like 2,700 at one point last year, I think it was. We're budgeting this so tightly that we're almost bound to ultimately have to do an amendment at some point, as we're going to have to do this year, because we're projecting months and months in advance, and we don't know what's going to happen with those. We can anticipate the employees. We can anticipate those kind of things. But we've got so many variables that it makes me comfortable with it, because I know what we have in reserves. Right now we have probably, what do we say, close to $4 million to handle a bust in the budget, like we're going to have this year, because we didn't anticipate and could not have anticipated some of our fees, some of the things that we have to pay for. And so the only thing that makes me, what makes me very comfortable with it, to answer your question, yes, is that it's a good budget because we have handled our finances wisely and we have a healthy carryover in our budget from year to year, simply because we have funds up to like $4 million that are at our discretion. I will tell you that eventually, and it's not going to be long, spending the amount of money we're spending, you're not going to have that cushion, and it's going to go away in about 4 or 5 years. So I would be looking ahead at that point, planning very strategically. And I drop this on the next person, whoever is here, but I would mention to his or her face, yes, you need to look at this. You do a five-year plan. See where you're going to be. And then you can see how well you're being judged today. But yes, I would. This is a good budget. It really is for our purposes in 2017. Yes,
and
indeed.
You think that our department's head have acted as frugal as possible?
And yes, sir, I'm very tight, very conservative, I admit it. I don't even have cards made because I'm not going to be here long enough to use them.
Council, the only thing other than that, Chief, I thank you for bringing that person forward. My opinion on that is you continue to keep our streets safe, continue to keep our neighborhoods intact to what we're accustomed to here in Castle Hills. You set up the STEP program. This additional officer in what I see here, and the questions were our budget of $3.5 million in 2003 to $7.5 million now, tells you a lot of business is going through this place. Thanks for keeping the crime at bay. And I don't see how you're gonna do it with just one more man. I really don't, but it is what it is. Jerry, while we're talking about this, you're looking ahead with this assistant chief. I can't tell you how many emails I had on that and calls thanking us as a council and a city for looking ahead. Although Mr. Dover may not be the next chief, the point is we have somebody who is taking the reins, and you're teaching what you do, and that's more than just what a lot of people think fire chiefs do. I mean, you know, he's out there doing inspections, he's out there doing this, he's out there doing that. It's more than just sitting in the office and taking a look at your trophies there. Hang on. Yes, go ahead. Go ahead, Frank.
Chief, I was asked by a couple of people, and I told them, and I'll just do it in public so to make sure everybody hears it. It's the chief's position, whether it be fire, police, whatever. You'll recommend to us who you feel is the best party that we should take on. But it's still going to be council's decision on hiring that person. Is that correct? Thank you.
Okay. But thank you for looking ahead, taking care of that gap. Lastly, Mike, you've pulled it all together. You've brought this together. You've worked with Janet, Kim, Suzanne. All y'all worked together to pull this together. And I don't see how you do it with just one part-time person. Okay, that we're bringing on. So thank you for doing that. With that said, this calls for a roll call vote, and we'll call for the vote in just a moment. Anything else? Anything else? I want to point out that we had a sign-up sheet back there, and I guess we're doing things right. And nobody signed up to speak. Not a single person. I'm sorry? We had a sign-up sheet back there, though. Mike? Okay, with that said, we want to make sure, because it's a general rule that you can sign up for an item. The sheets were back there. So is there anybody at this time that would like to speak on the agenda? Because it is a line item on line item 2, which is adopting the official budget of 2007. And there are sign-up sheets back there, so no one signed up. Is there anyone that I missed or that would like to speak on the 2017 budget? Okay, guess not. With that said, this will be a roll call vote. This is, and I believe it has to be read out loud. Is that correct, Mike? There's something that has to be read as far as more than the line item. Is that correct? Okay, thank you very much. So with that said, item number 2 is consider and act upon an ordinance number 2016-09-26, an ordinance adopting the fiscal year 2017 budget. We had a motion by who? And a second by who? Okay. So this is a roll call vote. Mr. Trevino, how do you vote, sir?
I vote to adopt it.
Okay. Mr. Daggett?
Yay.
Mr. Squire?
Aye.
Mr. Paul? Mr. Gregory?
No.
Okay, let the record show that it went, it passed 4-1. Okay. With that said, we're moving on to item 3, which is consider and act upon the ordinance number 2016-09, 2-6-A. Yes? Yes, we're, sure can. Okay, we're going to take a 5-minute recess, please. It is now, let's do 10 minutes. It's now 7:01. We'll convene at 7:11. Well, he did what he's told.
That's temporary.
Thank you.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, it is now 7:12, and we're going to get started. Okay, John. No, go ahead, John. You have a question to ask, Mr. Shands? Go ahead. Okay, let it show. Looks like we're a councilman short. Let the minutes show that we are a councilman short, please. Did Douglas say where he was going, or I guess he just didn't want to be here anymore? Okay. Well, that's weird. Didn't say anything to me either, so I guess that's the way things work. All right. With that said, Council, we're going to move on to consider and act upon ordinance number 2016-09-26A, an ordinance adopting the 2016 tax rate of 0.501345 at $100 of taxable valuation. The proposed 2016 tax rate will increase more property taxes by $220,940, or 7.5%, 5.1%. What? Mike, see the proper verbiage?
Yes, Mayor, go ahead. Okay. No, this is.
Oh, the one down under 5, 4?
3.
Okay.
Yeah. The 220, there's so much same stuff.
Oh, the motion is right in front
confusing.
Of you. Thank
yeah.
you. So I guess I need glasses too, besides hearing aids, since I don't hear very well. Okay. Did everyone hear that? Hang on. Let's start back over. Consider and act upon ordinance number 2016-09-26A, an ordinance adopting the 2016 tax rate of 0.501345 at $100 of taxable valuation. The proposed 2016 tax rate will increase property taxes by $220,940, or 7.51%. Do I have a motion, please?
Motion.
Second. Okay, there's no discussion because we already did that. So with that said, this is a roll call vote. Mr. Trevino?
Mayor, before the motion, remember you have to have the state law verbiage in Truth in Taxation, which should be before you. Someone must make a motion that the property tax rate be increased by the adoption of a tax rate of 0.501345 on each $100 valuation property, which is effectively a 6.06% increase in the tax rate. What that says is, when you do that, if I can explain before everybody gets confused, this is not an increase in the tax rate or the amount from last year. If you've lived in the city for 5 years or however long we've had this same tax rate, your taxes on a $100,000 home will still be $501.34. Nothing has changed. What Truth in Taxation says is you must advise the taxpayers that you could have adopted a lesser tax rate if you would have been willing to accept the same amount of money in last year's budget that tax would have raised. So that you would raise in this year's budget.
Okay,
so
let's do this right.
That's the confusing part.
I've read the motion, and since Mr. Daggett so moved, you so moved, right?
Yes.
So go ahead and read that.
So I move that the property tax rate be increased by the adoption of a tax rate of 0.501345 on each $100 valuation of property, which is effectively a 6.06% increase in the tax rate.
And he's okay, good. So we have Mr. Trevino, how do you vote, sir?
I agree with that.
Mr. Daggett?
Yay.
Mr. Squire?
Yay.
Mr. Paul, yay. This does take a majority of council, which we have four. Mr. Gregory isn't present. Be sure and put that in the notes, okay? So with that said, we have a 4-2 absent. So it passes. Thank you, council. All right, let's go on to the next item, which is item number
four.
Consider and act upon an ordinance 2016-0926B ratifying the fiscal year 2016 budget, raising more property tax than last year's budget by $220,940 or 7.51%, and the amount of $50,569 is tax revenue to be raised from the new property tax added to the tax roll this year. Do I have a motion? Do I have a second?
A second.
Okay, all in favor? It is unanimous with one absent. Okay, let's move on to consider approval of the Crime Control Prevention District adoption budget submitted for fiscal 2017. Let's get a motion, and then I think we're going to do some discussion.
I'll motion.
Second? Thank you, Mr. Trevino. We have a motion and a second on the table. Is there any discussion that needs to be or explanation from anyone here on council?
I'd like a summary from the chief.
Okay.
On that, if we could,
summary,
please.
Chief.
Full summary. Got it. All right. I'll make it quick and painless.
Let's make a quick summary, okay?
You have it in front of you, councilman? Do you have it in front of you? Okay.
So, yes, I do.
In summary, patrol cars, or I'm going to go by line item, 8105, 8107, 8110, 8115, 8120, 8125, 9015, and 9025 are reoccurring every year. So as you, if you add up those numbers, you see that is the lion's share of the budget. The additional line items, such as admin support, some CID training, ammunition, some dispatch training, those are relatively small, fluid numbers for the most part. And nearly remains the same year to year because of the lion's share items that we have to purchase on a rotating basis, which is 3 years for a patrol fleet, 5 years for admin vehicles, and in 3 years for our MDTs, and 5 years on our video cameras for our vehicles. So that takes up the lion's share of our CCPD budget. We're not really dealing with, it is a lot of money, but not relative to our general fund budget, approximately $235,000. And we're forecasting about $240,000 to come in, so we're looking at about a $5,000 surplus.
And as I read this budget, I mean, 2015 was 240, 2016 was 231, you're looking at 235, so you're basically holding the budget then, correct?
Sure, the last sentence.
The current year you're saying is 235, so you're holding your budget the last 3 years.
Yes, sir, I'm doing my best.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Squire. Is there anyone else that had any comments or questions?
Just one question for
Mr.
me.
Mr. Paul?
Chief, we're developing a lot of cash, so I presume that is for contingency situations. Could you give us an example?
We carry about 6 months, 8 months of reserves in our CCPD budget, which is equal to what we should be doing in our general fund budget as well. And keep in mind, this budget, or CCPD, is over 10 years old. So it's taken us about 10 years to acquire about
this is cumulative, right?
Cumulative funds, yes, sir. And on rare occasion, we need a capital purchase of some item for police function. And we, for tasers, for example, we had a capital purchase for tasers for the guys. And we usually take that out of the inclusive accumulated funds.
Okay.
When they arise.
Thank you.
Okay. Sure, John, go ahead.
Chief, when the budget was debated and I guess and approved, Was it a unanimous approval?
The best I recall, yes, sir, it was.
Okay, thank you, Chief.
Thank you, Mr. Squire. Okay, we had we have a motion, we have a second on the table. We had questions. Any, all in favor? It's unanimous with one absent. Okay, consider the recommendation of Architectural Review Committee regarding an application from Mark T. Murkowski and Tim Peterson on behalf of Most Rev Gusto Garcia Siller, M. period S. P. period S. regarding Antonian College Preparatory High School for the proposed renovation without expansion of the existing 13,270 square foot building located on the southeast corner of the campus, repurposing the got to get some glasses here. Repurposing the building from a retreat center to a resource center for students and classrooms. The proposed renovation site is located at 6425 West Avenue, legal description CB5005A, Block 8, Lot 1. We're opening, there will be a public hearing on this, so it is now 7:19, and the public hearing is now open. Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am.
I'm the architect representing the project. Thank you so much.
Hang on, we got to close this thing. Okay. We're going to close the public hearing. It is now 7:20. Okay. Do I have a motion and a second for this item to move forward?
Motion.
Second? Good. Okay, we have a motion and a second. Sir?
Mayor and Council, thank you for letting me present this project to you this evening. My name is Mark T. Murkowski. I'm the architect on this project. And if Kim will help me run the projector slide, I'll go through these pretty quickly. Is that work coming on? It was working earlier when we came here, so we'll see what happens. There it comes.
Mr. Trevino is recusing himself from the vote on this particular item. This doesn't take a majority, does it, of council?
Three.
Okay, good. We've got three.
There we go.
Mike, we're in a special meeting, aren't we? Doesn't it take four? Can you get Douglas on the phone, see if he can come back? Okay, if it does take four, we need to get Douglas on the phone and get him back here.
Yes, the clicker was...
Go ahead, sir.
It was missing. So this is the project here. This is the project site. And as mentioned, the building that we're renovating is this building here on the southeast corner, this being West Avenue. Fox Hall is kind of over on this end here. So that's the existing two-story building that's going to be repurposed. Next slide, please. Again, if you're familiar with the street view of the building, this is a two-story building that's been there since the early 1960s. Precast panel, tilt wall, exposed aggregate. This is kind of the front entrance. It's pretty much sheltered by trees from the West Avenue view. And that's what the existing building looks like now. Next slide, please. Again, this is the footprint of the building that we're repurposing with the code analysis that we're asked to submit in our package. The building will be sprinkled. It's not presently now. This is the first floor of that retreat center as it gets renovated. Again, this is the original entrance to the building. This is the resource center in here. This is one of their computer classrooms associated with the resource center. They have some study classrooms here, some storage, some restrooms over here. So that's the first floor plan of the renovation. This is the second floor, which has a rear entrance here from the chapel behind us. Is a series of ramps. These are the existing fire stairs that will remain. And this is the rearrangements of the classrooms upstairs. This is the elevation of the renovated building. Again, these are the exposed panels that are going to stay. These panels come off, and we're going to put spandrel glass in here. These panels will have brick applied to them that matches the auditorium, which is adjacent to this building, and also the chapel that's behind this building. And again, the symmetrical piece over here. This is a metal panel that's applied to the exterior of that exposed aggregate to kind of give it an updated look. I know a lot of the dealerships in San Antonio are using that exposed aluminum panels for kind of giving it a new look. I'm trying to update this building as well. Next slide, please. They asked to submit the package, and I also have the samples in this box of the material used. All the existing window openings will be reglazed with the solar glass. This also is the material that we're using in the spandrel panels of the front entrance of the glass. Next one, please. This is the aluminum framing system for the windows. This is a mill finished aluminum, which is the same aluminum that's used on the existing school, so that all the building materials are similar in material makeup and finish. This is the king size brick. This is the actual brick that's on the chapel behind that building. So it matches the chapel we did several years ago behind this building. The auditorium, which is to the right of our building, has the same color brick. There's more of a blend in the old brick. That brick's not available, so this is what we selected for the chapel years ago, and we're going to bring it forward to the resource center as well. This is, a sample of the aluminum panel that gets applied in a horizontal band over the existing aggregate panels to kind of break them up horizontally, because those panels right now are very vertical. There is a little bit of stucco on this building. It'll be painted this beige color, which is the same color as the stucco on the chapel behind this, and it's the same color that's on the panels on the existing school that got covered up many years ago with stucco. This is the light fixture that's going to be placed at the entrance to the resource center at the first floor. Again, this is the aerial view of West Avenue. Again, this is that building. There's a few rooftop units on top of that roof now. They're going to be removed from the roof. Everything's going to be placed on the ground in a service yard over to this side, so nothing's on our rooftop besides roofing material. One of the other questions in the packet was in terms of dumpsters. The dumpster's located back here now. It'll stay back there now for that classroom use. There's no additional dumpsters for the purpose of that building. And again, there's no expansion to it. We're staying within the four walls that exist now. We're just doing the interior renovations. Next slide, please. In the packet, they asked about exterior lighting. Those are the existing fixtures that are on the building now. We're going to maintain those same fixtures for security reasons. The only addition we'll have, again, is the front entryway has the two decorative fixtures at the front door. And that pretty much describes the project, and I'd be happy to answer any questions you might have.
Thank you. We're going to start on the... Oh, yeah. We're going to start on the left this time. Mr. Daggett, did you have any questions for the gentleman while he's up there?
Not this time.
Thank you. Mr. Squire, did you have any questions for the gentleman while he was up here?
During the ARC meeting, and maybe I got to wait for Mike to get back here, was there any comments or questions from the ARC board? And were there any recommendations that they made beyond what you all submitted? And And I guess that's a question. I guess you can take it. You were there, I'm sure, so.
Right. There were some general discussions about some, with the lights existing, not existing. We kind of told them they were existing. We're adding any more, not subtracting any more lighting from them. I think there was only three present at the ARC, if I remember properly, so it was a small crowd. But nothing that I can recall. They said, we don't want this, we don't want that. They pretty much voted unanimously as we presented it. I think Janet might have asked some questions. I think it was Janet, maybe. There was a question about trees in front of the building, and but that was just talking about one of the pictures was the trees in front of the building between the West Avenue and their driveway itself, the cluster of trees, and we're not obviously
they're
touching
all
any of
those.
They're existing. They're going to stay there, and since we're not impacting any of that footprint, there's no other trees at this point in time that are going to be removed. We may come back to the ARC. The trees are on the front porch of that existing building. There's probably three trees that are the original tree, and there's several that are offspurts of that tree, and they're nothing more than a branch. In fact, one of them's kind of hitting the building right now. It's just a single limb. When we get this thing further down the road, we're probably going to come back and see if we can't raise the canopy of the existing trees so the front porch is more visible, and maybe take the ones that are nothing more than a growth off of the original trunk and minimize that. But that's another plan for another day and another request for to do those.
You mentioned this building is going to be sprinklered now. Is that correct? Mm-hmm. And it currently is not.
It's not. Correct.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. And so everything that's being done is going to meet our current code that we adopted. When was that? I forget the date of the adoption, but the current international.
ABC. International Building Code.
Yeah, okay.
And the plans, y'all's process really is that the plans get submitted as an application before we went to ARC. The plans got submitted. We actually have a permit's been approved pending a selection of a contractor to pick up the building permit, but the permit's in Janet's office, paid for and approved as drawn and as presented tonight with this same thing.
Okay. All the neighbors were informed of this?
We didn't have anybody that came in to file any kind of complaint or even come in to inquire.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. No further questions. Thank you.
Surprise.
Mr. Paul, did you have any questions to or comments for the thing? Okay. So we've got a motion. We have a second on the table. We have Mr. Trevino graciously stepping out of this one with one absent. So what was the motion again, Kim? Just to be sure, the motion was, consider the recommendation of Architectural Review Committee. Why don't you read this, okay? Because we already had the motion.
You can approve the recommendation of ARC. And
I thought we take it and decide we're going to approve or disapprove the application, not a referral from ARC, even though they referred, it's a good thing.
You can do that as well.
I think we approve the motion is to approve or disapprove the application, I believe.
The recommendation.
Whatever the recommendation is, we're approving the recommendation.
Okay.
Is the way it's read there.
Okay.
Mayor, I had a question as far as do we have can we legally vote on this issue being that this is a special meeting tonight?
Yes, we can.
That's been confirmed?
Yes. It has been confirmed, even though we have one Douglas Gregory absent.
Okay. Thank you, Mayor.
Okay, so we have a motion. We have a second on the table. Mr. Paul, you're good. Okay, all in favor? It's unanimous. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor. Thank you, Council.
Where's Mr. Trevino? Can he come back? Can I have my thing back? Thank you, buddy. I'm just stating the fact. Okay, the next item on the agenda is item 7. Where's Mr. Trevino? Okay. Oh, glad to have you back. You too. All right, we're going on to item number 7, which is consider the recommendation of the Architectural Review Committee regarding an application from Shauna Herbert, Trey Bree Holdings, LTD regarding tree removal in conjunction with the proposed development of 6812 West Avenue, Castle Hills, Texas. Legal description CB5778, Block 8, Lot NE1RR, 200 foot of 6 and 6808 West Avenue, Castle Hills, Texas. Legal description CB5778, Block 8, Lot 7 and 8 for ingress, egress under reciprocal easement in conjunction with proposed development of 6812 West Avenue, Castle Hills, Texas. Okay, there is a public hearing required on this item. We're going to open the public hearing. It is now 7:39. Anyone here to speak? Nope. Okay, so we're going to close the public hearing. It is now 7:39 and a half. Or go ahead and put 40. Okay. Do I have a motion to move this forward as read?
So move.
Second? Thank you. Okay, with that said.
Good evening. My name is Robert Copeland. I'm with NBC Engineers, a civil engineer. With me is Shanna Herbert, the developer, and Pete Offers, the landscape architect. We're here tonight to ask y'all for approval to remove certain trees on the tract described. And go ahead, Shanna. Okay, right now we're just asking for, it's gonna be like a two-step process. We're only asking for tree removal tonight. Once we, if we are successful and obtain approval of this, we'll come back in a few months for building approval. Okay, that's the location map showing where the site is. That's the aerial of the site showing how heavily treed this site is. Okay, what we're gonna, the reason we're here is this site had a tremendous amount of trees, a lot of really wonderful trees. And we did our best we could to save as many of these trees as possible. Go ahead, Shanna. During this removal process, Mr. Offers will speak to the trees we're removing, but I want to make a point, we're not removing any heritage trees at all. Okay, that's the existing building at the site that'll be removed. That's another existing structure out back. That's the building adjacent to this site. We're also, while that's up right now, I was gonna mention that's with that slide there. We've agreed with a neighbor to have a shared ingress egress, so we have two access points to West Avenue. And what you're seeing there would be the access on the neighbor's property. Okay, there's a overall, this rendering here, there's a couple renderings we have the architect did to show how many trees we're actually saving. And in reality, what we did was we located all the protected trees like we're supposed to, but there's a whole lot more trees out there that aren't really represented here that are smaller trees. We just didn't locate them. That's an aerial view of the same thing. Okay, and what we did when we went through this process, we went through maybe 7 to 9 site plans. And we went through multiple site plans to ensure we saved as many trees as possible. We tried one building, two buildings, two-story buildings, separate. We went through this over and over again. And also the most important thing we did was we had to meet life safety with the fire marshal. Our site plan as it's drawn is meets all the ordinances and requirements for the city. I just want to make that point. Go ahead, Shanna. Pardon? Pardon? Oh, no, I'm sorry. I was just saying, go ahead. This is the site plan we're showing, the landscape architect site plan showing that the trees that are being saved. And I think Mr. Offers will speak to this.
Thank you, Robert. My name is Peter Offers, and I'm a landscape architect practicing in Central Texas. This project, when it was brought to me, Ms. Herbert, and I went to the site, and we've been to the site now twice, and we've walked through and we've looked at every single tree on site. We have a detailed survey that was performed by a surveyor through Mr. Copeland's office to locate every tree. And then what we did is we went on site and actually viewed each tree on site. The architects had already worked and developed the plan where they had located the larger trees on site, the surveyor had, and they worked around, and you'll notice how the parking curves and shapes around a number of the larger trees on site. And what we did is we went out and actually inspected every single tree. And what we found is that in the front portion of the site, that portion that's closest to the street, a lot of the trees there had been had underneath them a lot of parking and different developments over the years. And those trees had been cut and pruned and cut and pruned many, many times over the years. And what happened is you know, live oaks and how they'll have a beautiful shape out and you have these outgrowth of the limbs and whatnot. These trees mostly have been just been cut and shaped up to where you just have a limb going up and a little top canopy left. And so most of the shape and the form of the trees has been destroyed. And as a result of that, we found a number of the trees that were beginning to go into what we call decline, that they're not going to really grow anymore, they're not going to really be of much value anymore, and they're going to just begin to die back, even to the point that some trees on site had been topped out and things like that. So what we did is went through and determined all of those trees that we felt were in decline, then came back and worked with the plan in that respect. We maintained as many of the existing good quality trees as we can. And the preponderance of the trees on this site are live oak trees. There are a few cedar elms, and there's a couple of other things, a china berry in the back that doesn't count, a few other things. But we tried to develop and work around those existing trees that were really of a very good quality that we felt like we wanted to maintain. As a result of that, we wound up, and I can't see the percentage up there, but it's around 70%, a little over 70% of the trees. After we took out the ones that were in decline, we're saving almost a little over 70% of the trees on the site. You have any questions from there?
Any questions, anyone? Mr. Trevino? Mr. Daggett?
Not yet.
Mr. Squire?
No.
Okay. Mr. Paul? And I don't have any questions either. So we have a motion and a second on the table. As I'm famous for, I always like to lighten up the conversation. All the trees that you made didn't block the satellite, so we can make sure that we get the text. Okay, good. All right. With that said, we have a motion. We have a second on the table.
Can you? Who motioned and who second? Did you motion?
Yeah, you motioned. And I think you second.
Not this one. Hey, Frank did second.
You seconded it, Frank. Okay, so we have a motion. We really do know what we're doing up here, okay? So we have a motion and we have a second on the table. John, go ahead.
Yeah. In regards to the, I guess I'm sorry, I'm looking at this picture. In regards to these trees, you said a lot of them were already topped out or topped?
They were. As you get in there, you'll find trees that were cut and shaped. A lot of the lower limbs were taken, but then in the back, there's actually some that are topped off. So you have a combination of some of both.
Okay.
Mixed through there. Yes,
sir. And in total, did you get a count on how many trees you're taking out?
No, sir. I mean, we have a list of every single tree, and on the we have a list in what we call the disposition of each tree. If it's one that we call the in decline, if it's one that's to be removed, one to be saved. So we have a total list of the trees. I can't tell you exactly.
And they're marked at this point, so you know which ones are going to go and which ones aren't.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Okay. In the ARC meeting, real quick, what was the discussion in the ARC, or was there any questions that were added, asked, or any additional? Did the board ask them to do anything more than what was presented?
Janet was actually at this meeting. I was not. However, after reading over her minutes and also at the recommendation, it passed unanimously.
Unanimously, okay. But there's no additional requirements they put forward?
Nope.
Okay, thank you. No more questions.
Thank you, Mr. Squire. Anyone else? Paul, you okay?
I'm okay, but I gotta ask the question.
Okay.
I walked the lot back there, and it looks like there's a lot of trash trees, and that's what you're gonna be taking out, I presume.
All of those, yes, sir.
And the next question I have is, and I just have to ask it, I have no reason to not believe it. You're a certified arborist, right?
No, sir, I'm a landscape architect.
Okay, yes, so you say that these trees have been inventoried, they're gonna stay. we have every right to expect that that's the way it's going to work.
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, Mr. Paul, Mr. Daggett, do you have any follow-up question?
I went and walked the property, and it's an excessively dense property with trees, and it's unusable in its current form without removal of some trees. And I know our ordinance is there to protect our trees, but it doesn't really deal with properties that are overly excessive. And so there has to be common sense and thought like this to make a property useful. That's all I have.
Thank you, Mr. Trevino. Okay, so we have a motion, we have a second on the table. Gentlemen, thank you, Mr. Yates and company, and for coming back, redoing this property over there, and showing some faith that we're going to move forward with things. Thank you, Council, for having an open mind on this. With that said, all in favor? All opposed? One absent, Douglas Gregory. So, we've got that done.
Thank you.
Thank you, gentlemen. Okay, do we have a motion for adjournment? Do we have a second? Thank you. Four, one absent. I want that in there. We already did. Remember, I did it. It was only 1 minute, 10 seconds. Come on, buddy.